بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. All praise and thanks belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May the peace and blessing of Allah be upon His servant and final messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As to what follows, my dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, what I wanted to begin with is a story. And this is a story of a companion by the name of Murthad ibn Abi Murthad al-Ghanawi radiyallahu anhu. Not very famous, we haven't heard about him, but let's get to know about him and what we can learn from him as being a true follower of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So my brothers and sisters, Murthad radiyallahu anhu, he lived in Mecca. And he had a girlfriend in Mecca, her name was Anaq. And of course, they weren't married, so they had a relationship that is just like any other relationship, in where he would spend nights with her, he would spend time with her, he would drink with her, and so on. A few years go by, and Islam comes. It finally arrives, and he accepts Islam. And the event of the Hijrah takes place to Al-Madinah. So eventually, he had no other choice but to sacrifice his relationship with this girl, Anaq. He sacrificed that relationship for the sake of Allah, and he migrated with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from Mecca until he reached Al-Madinah, and all the other Sahaba radiallahu anhum did the migration as well. A few months go by in Medina. It was very difficult for Murthad radiallahu anhu to give up what he gave up. I mean, there was intense and strong love between them, which over in this story you'll find out exactly what that means. So when he's in Medina, the problem is that in Mecca there are still prisoners of the believers, that as they were trying to escape Mecca, they were captured by Quraysh and they were imprisoned and they were tortured and they weren't able to go anywhere. So when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam arrives to Medina, the first thing he does is that he handpicks, he selects and he chooses some of the Sahaba that were strong, that were tough, that were full of might and power. And he chose them so that he sends them back to Medina, so back to Mecca, so they can go into Mecca and free the prisoners of the believers and get them out of trouble. So he and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is choosing some Sahaba, and he chooses from among them Murthad al-Ghanawi radiyallahu anhu. Murthad was a tough man, he was strong, and he had just accepted Islam, he's migrated, and he's selected for this mission to go and free some of his brothers that are still trapped in Mecca. So now he comments and he narrates the story, and he says, I left Medina, and I began to approach Mecca, and as we got close to Mecca, he said, فَانْتَهَيْتُ إِلَىٰ حَائِطٍ مِّنْ حَوَائِطِ مَكَّةٍ فِي لَيْلَةٍ مُقْمِرَةٍ. He says, as I reached Mecca, it was a night, a full moon's night. So it was a bright night, the moon was out, and he reached at night, and he said, I went until I reached one of the walls of Mecca. And he stuck himself to the wall, because obviously he doesn't want to be found and he doesn't want to be seen, and he began to walk alongside this wall. And he says, as I'm walking, I see Anaq, she saw me. And she said, Murthad, she found him, she recognized him from his shadow. The ulama, rahimahumullah, when they discussed this hadith, they said that's the intense love that was between them, that as a matter, she just saw his shadow and she knew he was. So she said, Murthad, is that you? And he kept quiet, he didn't say anything. Obviously, he doesn't want to put himself into trouble or want to expose himself, so he remained silent. But where is he going to go? She said again, Murthad. And now this time, he gave in and he said, Murthad, yeah, it's me. So then she said to him, Ahlan wa marhaban, halumma bit indana layla. She said, oh, welcome. She's remembering the old days she had with Murthad radiallahu anhu, reliving those days and what we used to live in. So she said to him, halumma bit indana layla. She said, come tonight, come over and sleep over my place tonight. So without hesitation, radiallahu anhu, he stood right in front of her and he said, ya Anaq, inna Allah harrama zina. He said, Anaq, Allah Azza wa Jalla has made zina, has made adultery impermissible. It's haram. I'm in a different religion and things are very different here. That is absolutely incorrect for me to pursue with you and go home tonight. So she, being a disbeliever, she's got no idea what this halal and haram is and what this zina is. So يعني, she's confused. And she said to him, what do you mean, zina? يعني, it's as though she felt like she's been accused in her dignity and her honor. She felt like she's being slandered. So she said to him, listen, if you don't come tonight with me, I'm going to scream out from here that you're the one who's coming into Mecca, picking up the prisoners and freeing them. For he heard that and he began to run. And he said, حَتَّ انْتَهَيْتُ إِلَى الْخَنْدَمَةِ. As he's running towards a mountain in Mecca called Al-Khandama. And she screams out, يَا أَهْلَ مَكَّةِ إِنَّ هَذَا الرَّجُلَ يَحْمِلُ أَسْرَاكُمْ. She said, oh people of Mecca, this is the man who comes in and carries your prisoners and he frees them. So he began to run as fast as he can. He gets to the mountain Al-Khandama and he hides in a cave that he knows. He was a Meccan boy, so he knows around. He gets into the cave and he hides in there. And he says, I can count almost 8 men of the strong men of Mecca. They were on their horses and they're following me. So they get to him and they're following and they're on the mountain and they're searching for him. And they said they spent a while on the mountain and he's hidden in the cave and he's really silent so that obviously they don't catch him out. And he says, until they gave up the search, so everyone got onto their horses, about to go down the mountain and just go back to their houses. And he says, except for one of him, and this is a hadith in Tirmidhi, rahimahullah, he says, one of them, he came and he wanted to urinate. So he began to urinate and his urine, bala ala ra'si, he urinated on my head, fa'a'mahu Allahu anni, and Allah blinded him that he did not see me. So this was a karama. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him a miracle that happens to mankind other than, yani it happens to human beings other than the prophets. That's what he's saying in the narration. So they went, and what would you think Marthad radiallahu anhu is going to do? He did not just pick himself up and go straight back to Medina. He didn't do that. He's there, he's on a mission, he doesn't want to upset Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his brother in Mecca that is waiting for him. So he goes back into Mecca once again, and this time he gets there successfully. He finds the man chained on the floor, and he's put like in the middle of Mecca. So he unties him basically, and he puts him on his back. Remember, Marthad was a strong man, and he walks with him until he reaches a place known as Al-Idhkhir, which is just outside Mecca. Once he gets there, he puts the brother down, the Sahabi down, and he cuts off the iron feathers that were on his feet and the chains that were in his hand and so on, so that the Sahabi radiallahu anhu could walk on his own. And then they make their way until they reach Al-Madinah. Walhamdulillah, successful, he got his brother released. Now, subhanallah, he gets to Al-Madinah, and the next day, listen to this part really carefully. He comes to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he says, Ya Rasulullah, he's going to ask him a question. You wouldn't even imagine he's going to ask this question. He says to him, Ya Rasulullah, ذَلِّي أَنْ أَنْكِحَ عَنَاقٍ. He says, Ya Rasulullah, please give me permission that I go back to Mecca and get married to my girlfriend, Anaq. Give me permission to go. When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the narration it says, and by the way, she almost killed him. She almost killed him. But this is the intense love that was between them. He says, give me permission to go back and marry her. In the narration it says, in Abu Dawood it says, فَأَمْسَكَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ. In a Tirmidhi it says, فَسَكَتَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. Powerful. The narration says that Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam remained silent. He did not speak. He was speechless. Al-Ulama rahimahumullah, they began to explain this speechlessness of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Why did he remain silent? Even though the answer is very clear. I mean, the Quran has already revealed way before a few months. Allah Azza wa Jalla said, وَلَا تَنْكِحُ الْمُشْرِكَاتِ حَتَّى يُؤْمِنْ. Allah has made that law very clear, that it's not allowed for a believer to get married to a disbeliever. And that's exactly what anaq is. So the answer is, مرفض, no, goodbye. But the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam doesn't answer. Wal ulama rahimahum Allah, they explain that. They say that the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was feeling what مرفض رضي الله عنه was going through. It's not easy. He loved the girl. And so just to dismiss him and just give him a bold answer, look, it's haram, just go. He's not going to swallow that really easy. And he's going to remain hurt all his life. When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he acknowledges this sensitive situation. And that's something we're supposed to do. There are some people that would come and they would complain about something. For example, is this haram? Can I do this? I've been doing this for all my life. Am I able to continue in it? And we just, brother, it's haram, salaamu alaykum. Sister, what are you talking about? It's haram, goodbye. Then Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wasn't like that. He would actually look into the person. It's not an easy situation. Someone has loved a girl for all his life in Mecca, and he spent most of the time with her, and he's coming to you for direction. How are you going to answer this situation? Very sensitive. For Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam remained silent. It was so sensitive that Allah azza wa jal sends down an ayah from above seven heavens to treat this case of Marthad radiallahu anhu. Subhanallah. For Allah Azza wa Jal reveals unto Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, الزاني لا ينكح إلا زانية أو مشركة والزانية لا ينكحها إلا زان أو مشرك وحرم ذلك على المؤمنين. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam received this wahi. He gets up and he faces Marthad and he says to him, Marthad, Allah has just revealed, الزاني لا ينكح إلا زانية أو مشركة. The adulterer shall not marry anyone except an adulteress or a disbeliever. And the adulteress shall not get married to anyone except an adulterer or a disbeliever. وَحُرِّمَ ذَٰلِكَ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And Allah has made this impermissible upon the believers. لَا تَنْكِحَا يَا مَرْثَدْ. Don't get married to her, O Marthad. Marthad radiallahu anhu listens to this ayah, and he listens to the advice of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he gets up and he is so happy. He's full of joy and he is full of pleasure and contentment from the inside. You know why? Because Allah declared him from among the mu'mineen. Allah said, وَحُرِّمَ ذَٰلِكَ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Ya Marthad, you're from the mu'mineen. You're from the believers. And you're not supposed to do that. When Allah and your messenger say something, listen to it and do it straight away. He gets up and it's as though nothing has ever entered his heart of love in his life. These are the true followers of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That was their attitude. No matter how much they're attached to something, they would let it go in an instant if they knew that this would displease Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Marthad radiallahu anhu understood, if I pursue in this marriage, it'll upset Allah. It'll anger Allah. It'll earn me Allah's punishment. It's not worth it. So he lets it go and he moves forward in life. Well, subhanallah, my brothers and sisters, look at this. Marthad radiallahu anhu, he did not the next day, he didn't go around to the Sahaba and say to them, Ya Sahaba, someone please find me a solution. Ya Rasulullah, I can't leave my heart. I need this girl in my life. Ya Rasulullah, I sleep and I see her in my dream. I wake up and I see her in front of me. He could have spent the rest of his life depressed and worried and upset, but he didn't do that. He understood that wouldn't bring him the pleasure of Allah. So he pursued in life. And look at this, look how beautiful this is. Marthad radiallahu anhu, after this incident, he lived 1.5 years. 1.5 years he lived. He could have lived that 1.5 years in depression. But because he made the decision to step over his own desire and to step over his own nafs and what he wants for himself for the sake of Allah and in obedience of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and because he did that decision, look what he gained, radiallahu anhu. Look what he gained. Number one, he gained a karama. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him a miracle during his life. And that is that when that person of Mecca urinated on him and did not see him, Allah gave him a miracle in his life. Number two, Allah Azza wa Jal would bless Marthad radiallahu anhu, that he would place him under his shade on the Day of Judgment. You know the hadith in Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he says that one of the seven types that get to be shaded under the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Day of Judgment is a person in which a woman came to and she called him and he said to her, Inni akhafullah. That's exactly what Marthad radiallahu anhu did. So he gained that kind of reward that he's under the shade of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Day of Judgment. Further to this, Marthad radiallahu anhu pursued in life and he went ahead in his knowledge and he became an expert in the Quran. Imagine he kept recalling that woman. What would have happened to him? Wala Quran, no knowledge, nothing would have happened to him. But because he put it behind his back, he became an expert in his Quran. He became a student of knowledge of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to the point where after he, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sends an army, he sends an army out to Qarra wa Adl, and this battle was called Dhat al-Raji'. He was an Amir. He became an Amir after it, on a group, on an army that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent to fight the disbelievers for a betrayal they did to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it is over there where he attained martyrdom, and that's how he died as a shadeed. Look how much he gained because he understood what it means to be a follower of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's the goodness he gained. And this, my brothers and sisters, is the actual point of this entire conference and of the entire life, that you're obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you're obedient to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and as a result, that is equal to obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah Azza wa Jalla says in the Quran, مَنْ يُطِعِ الرَّسُولِ فَقَدْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهِ. Anyone who obeyed the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he has indeed obeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تُقَدِّمُوا بَيْنَ يَدَيِ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. O you who believe, don't advance and don't put anything before the Messenger and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing at all. Not even an emotion that you feel inside. You know, wallahi, I tell you, this is a reality. You come to a brother or you're a sister and you say, brother, sister, why haven't you repented yet? Why haven't you connected with Allah yet? Why haven't you started praying yet? You know what the answer is? Because there's something in my life that I'm still attached to of haram and I'm not ready to repent yet. Sister, why haven't you worn the hijab yet? Because I'm scared. I don't know how my family will take it, how my friends will look at me. I'm still scared. So that's why I haven't done it yet. Later on, I'll do it. But when you do that, and which that's your excuse, that means you haven't implemented the ayah of لا تقدموا بين يدي الله ورسوله. Don't put anything before Allah and His Messenger, not even an emotion. Not even Allah, I love this thing and that's why I'm delayed in my tawbah. I'm scared of this thing and that's why I'm delayed in my tawbah. That is not true obedience to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and in result, obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The believer's response whenever he hears a commandment from Allah or His Messenger, Allah Azza wa Jal says in Surah An-Nur, He says, إِنَّمَا كَانَ قَوْلَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذَا دُعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ لِيَحْكُمَ بَيْنَهُمْ أَنْ يَقُولُوا سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. That's the response of a believing man and a believing woman, that any time they're called to that which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells them to do, or Allah Azza wa Jal instructs them to do, they would respond by saying, سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. We hear and we obey. And so the believer in his food is سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. In what he drinks is سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. In the time he wakes up is سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. You don't have this, no, I want to sleep until I'm satisfied with my sleep. Then whenever I wake up, I pray Salat al-Fajr. In your sleep, the believer's sleep is supposed to be سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. My brothers and sisters, in the way you dress, it is supposed to be سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. Everything you would do in life is supposed to be سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. Then and only you qualify of being a true follower of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says in the Quran, وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَنْ يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ. That it is not, it's not allowed for a believing man or believing woman that when Allah Azza wa Jalla and His Messenger have made a decision on something, that they come up with their own decision. That's not allowed. It's not allowed. And if that happens, then that's a reflection of there is no iman in the heart. Well, subhanallah, the ayah that was revealed in the case of Marthad radiallahu anhu, it is in Surah An-Nur. In Surah An-Nur. You know what that means? Yani it's as though Allah Azza wa Jalla is saying that if you were to obey my messenger, and as a result obey me, I'll give you nur in your life. I'll give you that guidance that you need, and you'll get to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala according to where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to be. Subhanallah, I conclude that I'm going to end this last 5 minutes with one more story, my brothers and sisters, I share with you. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was once walking. And as he's walking, he sees Umar radiallahu anhu in the streets of Al-Madinah. He sees Umar radiallahu anhu in the streets of Al-Madinah. So he walks up to Umar radiallahu anhu and he takes by his hand like this. He holds onto his hand like this. Umar radiallahu anhu, because of that, he says to him, Umar radiallahu anhu says to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Wallahi innaka la ahabbu an-nasi ilay. He says, O Messenger of Allah, you're the most beloved of mankind to me. I love you so much. For Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says to Umar radiallahu anhu, more than your wealth? He says, yes, more than my wealth. He says to him, more than your children? He says, more than my children. He says, more than your family and your wife? He says, more than my family and my wife. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's hand is still in Umar radiallahu anhu's hand. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam pulls his hand away from Umar. And he says to him, and more than your nafs, more than yourself? Then Umar radiallahu anhu, he says, no, except that. So then the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, La ya Umar, you haven't reached that complete level of iman yet. For Umar radiallahu anhu, he walks away. And he begins to think, looking up to the sky, thinking to himself, the narrator of the hadith is his son Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu. He says, I observed my father going back to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as soon as he arrived to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Ya Rasulullah, I love you more than myself. I love you all I love you more than myself. When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, Al-ana ya Umar, right now you have attained the highest form of iman. His son Abdullah bin Umar, he says to us later on in the narration, I went to my father and I said to him, oh father, just a moment ago, you said you did not like Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam more than yourself. And moments after, you went back, you changed your mind, and you said to him, Ya Rasulullah, I love you more than I love myself. What brought you to that conclusion? How come you changed your mind? For listen to the answer, and this was what we're concluding with. He said to him, my dear son, I sat with myself, and I did a calculation. Who do I need more? Do I need myself more, or I need Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam more? And he said, oh my son, I concluded at the end of the day that without Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I would have still been in the midst of darkness and misguidance that I was in. Without Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who's going to open the door of the paradise for me? So this is why I concluded that I love him more than I love my own self. And this, my brothers and sisters, will only come. True love of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even more than yourself, will only come when you truly follow him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In everything that he spoke and told us, and in every single hasana, and in every deed and righteous act that he taught us until you adhere to it, and in every abstaining of that which he forbid us from, until you do that, you will never be a true lover of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And one of the greatest benefits in the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and in his following truly is that you earn Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's love as a result. Allah azza wa jalla, he says, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. Say, if you really loved me, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying to the people, say to the people, if they really loved me, then follow me, تَبِعُونِي, and follow him, and put all your emotions on the side, and all that you think about on the side, and follow him, and as a result, you earn Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's love, and your sins will be forgiven. And this is exactly the purpose of life. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us true followers of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask him subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us people of the Quran, people of the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Innahu waliyu thalika wal qadiru alayhi wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
والسابقون السابقون أولئك المقربون في جنات